Our next speaker is Dr. Martin Stepper, who I'm sure is very well known to most of you here today. He's a farming systems agronomist, formerly with the CSIRO, and that's where I first met Martin, when he was working with the CSIRO and was getting very, very disgruntled with that he couldn't promote more biological agriculture. And I'm sure that, Martin, looking back, that that was a challenging time in his life, but I'm sure to being working for the CSIRO now, he's on his true mission of speaking worldwide. I won't read all of this because it was in your book, and it's in your book, but absolutely promoting food, healthy soils, and the whole agro ecosystems getting it healthier. So I'd like to welcome Martin back to Young. Martin's spoken at many, many of our seminars, and as I say, has gone on to speak worldwide and promote this worldwide. So I welcome him back to Young, and thank you for coming.
Yeah, so welcome to this event in Young, the 10-year anniversary of the wildlife system. And the way Bill and Rhonda explained it as we started was quite an adventure 10 years ago. And so I will talk about like the biological farming in general, just the big picture again from the science world. And today you will hear from other people, like the practical results, like from Cam, and more theory from others. And over the next days as well, and going to the milk without properties to look in practical ways to more results. So this is the big picture of biological farming and how it will drive our future. So I'll talk today about these topics. Like, it's the demand for chemical-free healthy food that drives the biological system. Because if there's no demand from the public, then it will grow slower. And in the end, if that demand gets very big, governments can't stop and universities can't stop not promoting the biological farming. Because farming systems work in ecosystems, and functioning ecosystems are very complex, but they are resilient. If something happens, they can recover very easily. So we have to get that ecosystem back functioning in our landscape, and then we have a working farming system that can use less chemicals and less fertilizers. And that whole system is too complex for the single factor science. We need a holistic picture. And then the biosensitivity. The biosensitivity is we have to manage with feelings, not numbers. The biosensitivity is feeling things and seeing things rather than calculating things all the time. So I'll talk about the biosensitivity that's required in our farming. And then the change of paradigm in practice and science. So we have to change our thinking. And then we have to do self-development and participatory learning, because the departments of agriculture, CSIRO, universities, they still won't deliver this kind of knowledge for a long time to come. So we have to generate that knowledge in our own environment. So we built new knowledge network with locals and with companies like Wilet and agronomists associated with biological farming. And then that whole system will slow climate change by the carbon sequestration, by emission reduction, and by water retention, making a cooler landscape. So it's all these factors that are important, and that's the real sustainable system and the triple bottom line, like sustainable financially, so you can make a profit, sustainable for the environment, get a good ecosystem working, and socially sustainable, that it takes the pressures of families and you will be happy and healthy. So now I go into the talk, and like farming for the future for the planet Earth, because how planet Earth is now operating with all, like, more than 50% of the people now live in cities, with all the pollution in the cities, all the landfills, forests are still cut, lots of forests in the world are still being cut, deforestation is going on, electricity generation, planet Earth is heating up, global warming. So we have to stop that whole trend and we have to break away from that, and biological farming is the way to do it. And all those chemicals that are in our modern society make people and ecosystems sick. In the production system, it affects the quality of food and the quality of the ecosystem. So the more chemicals we use, the more fertilizers we use, the more that system starts to collapse. In the processing, so once that food goes from the family, from the farm to the processing factory, then in that system, all the food processing is for ease of use, taste, looks, shelf life, and it has to be cheap. So that's all the rubbish you can buy with the fresh food people. So all these synthetic colors, flavors, preservatives, the E numbers on your food, like the Dirty Dozen, it's now internationally recognized that they kill people. And then in the body care products, everything we smear on our body, we wash our hair with, and we color our hair with, etc. All those body care products contain chemicals that affect us as well. And then in medicine, all those drugs, all the chemicals. And like in the production, processing, body care and medicine, all those chemicals are, by our regulator, approved one by one. And like now, we get them in a cocktail. And those cocktails have never been tested by science. And science is now seeing the end result of that, all the chronic diseases. So the medical world starts to cure the chronic diseases rather than prevent the chemicals entering our bodies. And the more generations, for more generations, every generation that follows has more problems with those chemicals. Because a new body, a new child, will not see many of those chemicals as poisons, so they start to store them up in their body and creating all the problems. So the impact of cocktails is the big issue, so we have to minimize all the chemicals in our lives. Because we use it like for spraying crops, and fertilizing to get high yields, and then in the factory we use it for the preservatives, fast food, and like all the drinks, all the fussy drinks, they all have preservative in it. So if you drink a liter of that stuff a day, what does a preservative do? It kills bacteria. So then when in your intestinal system, it starts to kill things all the time. So that's happening in our intestinal system, and Carolyn was already talking about that. Like our intestinal system is very important, all the microbes, the bacteria in that system, it's an incredible machine. And that incredible machine is now, every generation, that machine starts to work less and less because of the chemicals that are in the body and can't be excreted anymore. So each next generation has more problems. So the transition to sustainable food, it's driven by consumer demand for free, chemical-free, organic, ecologically healthy food. And like consumers start to ask more and more about that because they discover by themselves that it's good. And of course, the medical world still is not on that track yet, but alternative medical people, of course, are on that track, and we'll hear of some here today as well. So it's very important to minimize those chemicals. And where do you go then? In the city, urban consumers, they go to farmer markets and they look for stands that have organic food or low chemical use. And then the community supported agriculture and box systems that you can buy every week, you get food in a box. So those systems are now improving, and that's the connection then between the producer and the consumer that's becoming stronger. So then the consumer knows where it comes from, and the consumer starts to trust the producer and for the low chemical use and healthy food with lots of minerals. And in the community, then we get community gardens and school gardens and street gardens, like the whole street turning out into a garden, the front and backyards, to capture the resources, not that the water, when it rains, the water doesn't flow through the system off to the ocean, no. The water is soaked in the landscape, in the street, and then you can grow fruit trees, you can grow veggies in the street for the whole community to eat and enjoy. And that's in lots happening in lots of cities. And like in Sydney, it's the Chippendale that has a street. And of course in Melbourne, the community garden, the Cirrus Garden has been going on for 25 years or whatever. So each city starts to, more and more people want to be actively involved in that good food production themselves. And that then drives the demand for better food. So if you then are doing biological farming, you can get a special market in urban cities to get that food there. So what happens to our intestinal system with the chemicals also happens in the landscape. So we get the trees dying from salinity, we get the dust storms, water erosion, wind erosion, everything can blow away, wash away, because the chemicals and the fertilizers kill the microbes that bind all the soil particles together. So once all the soil particles are loose, they can blow away, wash away very easily. So with the biological farming, we can make the soil aggregate stability so the soil is stable. And how do we do that? With the soil food web. So we stimulate the whole soil food web from the microbes, the bacteria, fungi up, And that whole web has to work to have a sustainable system. And our chemicals and fertilizers kill that system all the time. So then we get less and less native fertility in our paddocks. So then humans in a complex ecosystem, like the ecosystem is the whole landscape where we live in, like with the roads, the power lines, the rivers, the creeks, on your farm, it's the whole ecosystem. And in that ecosystem, all the microbes, all the living organisms are affected by each other. And if that whole web of life is active, then they can sort out how effective it is and how good it is. And they can keep it healthy, they can keep it strong. And this is a statement from Professor Duncan Brown, who said, for every action on a complex, interactive, dynamic system, there are unintended and unexpected consequences. In general, the unintended consequences are recognized later than those that are intended. So the whole science world works on intended consequences of what they study. And then 5 years later, 10 years later, you get problems. And then, because that's the unintended consequence. And then the science world take that problem and starts to make a new solution, which collapses after 3 years, 5 years. So that's the science world always looking for an intended consequence in a short term, like in the next 3 years, and they can sell that and they can get right scientific papers, and then it collapses and they can do another thing. So all these single factor research ends up with nothing. And what's sustainability? Well, sustainability is taking a long term view of how our actions affect future generations and making sure we don't deplete resources or cause pollution at rates faster than Earth is able to renew or recycle. And like in that science world and in our modern society, everything is linear. So we buy things, it doesn't work, we throw it away, it goes to the tip, goes to the landfill, goes up in the sky, greenhouse gases, etc. It's all linear thinking, and at the end of that linear line is always waste, waste, waste. So we get the cycle back. And in that cycle, the cycles of life, we go from birth through growth to death, decay, and in that decay, all the minerals, all the carbon is in that place to have the new birth starting, the new growth starting. And that's the principle of biological farming. We can try to get those cycles working again, and then we are profitable because we get lots of things for free, because nature gives us for free. So soil health through land management. Like ecosystems management, it increases the stability of soil structure and fertility. Through all the carbon that's pumped into the soil and all the biology that's active. We get efficiency in our water and mineral cycles. So all the minerals are recycled and the water retention, the water stays in the soil, infiltrates properly, and is used by plants to grow, and that whole cycle is very effective. So with our biological farming, we have very high water use efficiency. So the efficiency for every drop of rain is very high. And then we get a healthy soil, healthy plants, and healthy animals, and healthy humans that eat the food, because we get nutrient density of the food. The nutrient density, like all the nutrients, because the less nitrogen you use, the more the plant is stable and can pick up all the other minerals required to make strong cell walls. And then we recycle the plant residues and manures and we go back to the soil structure, fertility, etc. So that's very important. So soil health is associated with biology. If we don't have biology, we don't have a healthy soil. So then the ecosystem functioning, how can we get the ecosystem function? Well, we have to design the landscape. So we have to start with biodiversity. So in our pastures, we want to have many species in the pasture, like 20 species would be normal. And all different colors of flowers, because those have all different minerals as the main ingredient for animals to eat. So biodiversity is important. And then we have woodlands and wetlands, and wind breaks the shelter belts. So in our landscape, and we do that like on contour lines, not straight lines, and then that makes a very good environment for the soil biota, the soil living organisms, and the animals that graze on your pastures, and we have the least amount of rain, of water from the soil being evaporated by the hot, dry winds that blow over it. So we need to have to design that landscape to break it up in smaller components with tree lines. And of course in the trees are all the birds and the bees that are important for pollination. And then with permaculture principles, we can use like for the shelter belts, etc. But also to make swales that we prevent the water running off our property, that we force the water to infiltrate. And of course the Yomas key line, very important to follow the contour with like a culture plow, and then the water falls, when it rains, the water drops into that groove of the plow straight away, and we get a very productive system. And then natural sequence farming, Peter Andrews, to stop the gullies right at the start of the gully, again to force the rain to soak in the landscape, and all that water can then be available for our plant growth. So that's the principles of the landscape. And then once we have that good landscape, then we have to manage the paddock as well. Like, and that we do that with biological management. And of course, we'll hear more about that today from other speakers. So importance of soil management is, like in our farming systems, in our industrial farming, we maximize output through inputs. Like input-output, that's why we call it industrial farming. And you judge then the inputs to what you expect the output can be, depending on rainfall, etc. But in biological organic farming, we maximize soil health. Maximizing soil health is important. So feeding and protecting growing plants, who is doing that? Like in our industrial farming, we people, we feed our plants with nitrogen, fertilizer, phosphorus, etc. Then the plant grows out of balance, becomes sick. Insects come, disease come, so then we come out with the drum and we spray, we kill the insects, we kill the diseases. So we do the feeding and we do the protecting of our plants. In the biological farming, it's the soil organisms. The soil organisms feed the plant and the soil organisms protect the plant. And that's why we need like 15,000 species of soil microbes in the soil to protect the plant and to feed the plant. And then the 5% pathogens that want to attack our plants, want to eat our plants, can't get to the plant because the beneficials overpower them. So that's the system. So now we have our industrial farming and our organic farming. Like those two systems are happening, and there's lots of antagonism and dichotomy between the two systems, lots of emotions between like organic and industrial. Of course, the GMO in the industrial system, the court cases that we have had, all those things. So it's very difficult to jump now, and of course, 20 years ago, it was still easy to go from the left to the right, or relatively easy. But these days, with all the financial pressures, it's very difficult to make that step from the left to the right circle. Because the first 2 years, you're not allowed to use any chemical, any fertilizer, and you don't get higher prices, and you can't control the weeds. So the whole place starts to be eaten up by all the different insects and weeds and very difficult systems. So then you can end up with yields of only half the yields that you had before. So what we now discover with biological farming, it's a third way of farming. It's between the current farming and the organic farming. So you can go step by step from the current farming every year a little bit closer in the direction of organic. And I've now, there are many of you that have done, like that started biological farming 5 years ago, 10 years ago, that are here in this point, and they could become organic if they wanted, but then they choose not to become organic, but keep biological, because then you can always use a chemical or a little bit of fertilizer in case of need. And because we have increased our soil fertility so high, our soil structure is so stable, our ecosystem is so resilient, that a little bit of chemical, a little bit of fertilizer, doesn't change the system, doesn't affect the system. So we have to put our immune systems of our soils high, like a healthy soil with lots of bugs in the soil, and lots of carbon in the soil, has a high immune system, then we can use little bits of chemicals and fertilizers without negative impacts on the quality of the food. And that's the key, of course, that we want quality of food. But now, and that management, like the management from the left to the right, it's driven by biosensitivity. Like lots of organic farmers from the past that have very high yields now, like the same yields as their neighbors that are industrial farming, those high producing organic farmers have biosensitivity. They can sense the system. They have intuitive feelings, like a green thumb, a third eye, a gut feeling. No recipe farming. You have to feel it, you have to sense it. And those farmers are very successful in the biological system as well. So if you are in industrial farming and you always work according to the recipe with so many kilos of this, so many kilos of that, a liter of this, a liter of that, it's very difficult to make that step to biological farming. But then as you go make the first step and like you reduce your fertilizer 20% and start to use that money that you save with some biological stuff, and you see then the outcome of the good soils, the healthy soils, you can keep going that direction. And if you know what to look for in your paddock, if you know what to look for in your plants, you start to learn that biosensitivity. You start to develop that gut feeling. And then when you talk then to neighbors or people that are also on the biological track in your own district, you visit other farms, you hear what they say, what they see, then we develop that biosensitivity. Of course, what Carolyn was talking about earlier about China and Russia, but also India, in those cultures, and like Germany, I'm a Dutchman from Germanic culture, in those cultures there's still more awareness of nature, more gut feeling and sensing the whole system without the numbers. And those of you that, like in many cities, there are people with beautiful flower gardens, beautiful roses, without using chemicals. They have a green thumb, we say then. The same on the farm. Some of your neighbors or yourself, you might have a very good farm, and a lot of people are proud of that you have that good farm. And you might do that with feelings, with history, with wisdom. So biosensitivity is very important, but we can redevelop that whole sensitivity, because in our education system and in our university system, it's not accepted. And like me, as a scientist, I have intuition. And like in the Germanic cultures, intuition is accepted by men. In Anglo-Saxon culture, intuition is women's business. So it's cultural differences as well that play a role in what we can see in the world, what we are allowed to see. And then of course, make a perfect cake. That's like industrial farming, like you have all the ingredients and you put it on and you get a result. But like with a cake, with a recipe, I can give that recipe to each of you and then we can look at the results when you follow the recipe. If you do it for the first time, you get completely different results. Because you have to develop the feeling of the ingredients and the feeling of how long it has to be in the oven and how hot the oven is. So that's biology. And like farming is like making a cake. You have to feel and get the experience. And then some people, of course, they don't need scales to measure the ingredients for a cake as well. They just, by eye they do it and feeling they do it and they mix and they have a perfect system. So it's all intuition, it's feeling. Very important. So then we get to some pictures of the real world, like Colin Seiss that developed pasture cropping. And pasture cropping is like the ultimate of biological farming. Because you allow each green plant to grow. Whenever it rains, a green plant is allowed to grow. So that green plant pumps carbon in the soil. And of course it can be grazed then, or it can be stripped as a crop, like here the oats crop. And you can see the green pasture already of summer grasses coming through. So it's a very important system, very effective. And many districts it's now being developed. And then of course the other important thing is plant grazing, rotational grazing. So a big number of animals in a small space for a short time compared with set stock. Because in set stock, like this is on the southern tablelands, on the Monero, with love grass as the wheat in set stock. Here on the plant grazing, no love grass to be seen. Love grass is being eaten by the animals in that forced system. And they start to get used to it and they keep eating it. And then the clovers and the medics come back, the pH goes up through the biological management, and it's all very profitable system. This is in cropping, like wheats in cropping. Like this is a paddock split in two, like half is biological, the other half is conventional. If I show this picture and ask people, well, what part is the biological? People look at the tall grass and say, oh, the right side is biological. Now the right side is fleabane. Those that you are far away, you can't see fleabane, but it's fleabane that thrives on the conventional half of the paddock. On the biological half of the paddock, and this paddock was only in the second year of biology, no fleabane inside. You see this straight line through the middle? Like And fleabane is a weed that grows under compacted soils as well. And the more Roundup you use, the more compacted the soil becomes, the more fleabane you will have. You need a loose soil, and fleabane can't compete with the other plants. So it's all these things that we learn with biological farming. And then, of course, we harvest the results of the good soils, and this is from Ron and Beth Smith, with very high biosensitivity farming, organic, high, very high yields. On the left-hand side, you see their soil. You see their soil, like 60 centimeters deep, a foot of black stuff, all the carbon and roots going down. The neighboring block, the neighboring paddock, the typical dairy farm in South Gippsland, like 2 inches of topsoil, and then the solid clay underneath, no roots going there. So here you get this complete new bucket of water that can be stored, and plants can grow, and paddocks stay green for 6 weeks, 7 weeks longer than the neighbors. So that's the expression on Gippsland, and of course Colin Seis, the pictures as well, Christine Jones, like again 60 centimeters the roots going deep, while in the neighboring block the roots only go this deep. So that's what we can create in 10 years time, going from current farming to biological farming, to make that bucket underneath each plant much bigger, that more water can be used and higher yields will be the result. And this is the typical plant on the left hand side of the deep soils, like the roots. The roots don't have problems in being very dense, and like all the soil glued to the roots, the rhizosphere, very healthy soil. While on the right side is the difficult soil, the hard setting soil, that the roots grow through cracks and don't have as many roots, and the plants suffer. And this is like a picture I took, like in typical Riverina no-till system farm. They started no-till farming 5 years before this picture. I walk in September in paddock, and 5 paddocks I went into, every paddock the roots were like this, going flat. So if you are direct drilling and no-till systems in conventional systems and also in biological systems, use the shovel, dig up the plants, see where the roots go, because the roots tell the story. And of course this is then the landscape, Peter Andrews' property at Park Bylong, where he didn't use chemicals or fertilizers and soaked the water in the landscape. And this is in the middle of the drought of 2005, that you have a green property in the middle of the brown. So at the landscape scale, we got this enormous change. And of course this green area, the more, so if the whole valley would be like this, oh, that whole valley is evaporating, cooling the air, and rain clouds go from hot air to cool air. So if we have a whole valley with green grass, it will attract the clouds and it will drop more rain on it. And that's against, again, the global warming that's not then happening, it's cooling. So complexity of biological systems. So the scientists always say, where's the proof, where's the proof? And they want to do randomized trials to prove that the control is, that the biological farming is better than the control. But you can't do randomized trials on an experiment station with plots of 3 meters by 10 meters, or on a farm with plots 3 meters by 10 meters. You need to split paddocks, you need to have like 10 acre blocks to see the with and without. Because biology moves and chemicals move. You got interference in both systems. So that's why the science still says there's no difference between biological farming and current farming, and our current farming is good. But ecosystems are too complex for all links to be quantified by science. You can't measure all the things. So you have to look at the big picture, and you have to look at outcomes. Like the outcomes of a property. Look at all the inputs and all the outputs. Look at the soil quality and make judgment on that, rather than how it works. Because shapes and relationships in nature are not in fixed patterns. They change with the seasons, they change with the weather, they change with the soil type. So this is an ecosystem. So you see all those wheels and all those cogs, all different shapes and sizes, but they're all connected. One wheel turns very, the big wheel turns very slow, small wheels turn very fast. So this system, the ecosystem, has completely demolished. And like lots of those wheels are now have shrunk, so they're just spinning in a circle without activating all the others, and they get lost out of the system. So we have to reconnect all those parts back together again. And this is how the science world sees an ecosystem. Like all this multidisciplinary research, all the specialists, they try to make a puzzle. They fit all the pieces of the puzzle together, because they say that's our problem in farming, that all the pieces of the puzzle are loose and we have to fit them together. But those pieces are not the same all the time. You can't make that puzzle. It's not a puzzle with fixed pieces. So the science world can never solve that problem the way they are now doing it. We have to go back to the cogs, the wheels, etc. That it's such a complex system, we can't quantify it. So in our current science, we have missing links that stifle real solutions. We need keeping band-aids on dead soils while working on the symptoms. Like a band-aid on a dead soil doesn't work, so in 5 years' time you have to start doing something else again. And all the no-till systems now have big problems as well with compaction because the biology is not activated. And the true costs of failing systems are not included in the prices of what people pay in the shops. And that's the other fallacy of our whole system in the Western, well, in our world economies, that the true costs are not calculated. So you have to pay the price for that, and the consumer never pays for it. So we have to change that whole culture. And we can do that by stimulating a connection between urban consumers and rural producers to get a direct connection, like through farmer markets and through education, that you are doing the right thing with biological farming, and we can then start to see the true cost and reduce the true cost, and people can start to pay. So science and our current problems are created by unconnected, individual, single-factor solutions in part of the farming system that confuses the ecosystem. So like if you put that picture of the cogs and the wheels in the food web again in there, like if you put a lot of chemicals in there, then some of those wheels become very small and they don't function anymore. And if a specialist then works on that wheel, doesn't know the rest of the picture, they can't see that because it's the whole ecosystem that's interactive. And the other important part is we have been separating the science of production and environment within the same ecosystem. So you get all the environmental scientists saying completely different things because they don't have a clue what farming is, what production is like, and they rule the roost now. And like in the Murray-Darling Basin Plan, it's so complex now because it's a war between all those different factions, all those different disciplines on who is right. And of course each specialist knows more and more about less and less. So they all become dumb. So the genetic engineering as a solution, while DNA doesn't tell how it works, genes keep genes switching on and off all the time. They adapt to the local conditions, like the epigenetics that Carolyn was talking about. Very important concept. Because there's crosstalk between the genes and the environment, the G by E. But as I was growing with my science and always on farms making measurements, I discovered that the M of management is far more important than the environment. Because with the M of management, we can change the environment so much that the genes adopt themselves to that new environment. And old varieties can become very good again. And that's the power of genes, that we can switch them on and off with good management to make a healthy soil, and that healthy soil makes the genes more active again. And the classic example is like the Hunter River lucerne, which was the most productive lucerne in the 50s and 60s and 70s until the Russian aphid came. And then the Hunter River disappeared. There are now properties in eastern South Australia and the Western District of Victoria where the Hunter River lucerne is the most productive lucerne on that property, biological farming. Whitefly aphids don't touch that Hunter River, and it's the most productive. It outcompetes the hybrids. You change the condition. Conditions determine gene expression. Like in this picture, what do you see? Like the queen bee in the middle. Like the queen bee is like 50% bigger than the workers, and the queen bee is completely different mentally as well. She's the ruler. The DNA of the queen bee is exactly the same as the worker. Exactly the same DNA. But what happened was, like a larvae was fed with special food by the workers. Every day special food. And that larvae became the queen. So if we feed special food to something, rich food, high mineral density, we get a different physical expression and a different mental expression with the same genes. So what do genes tell us? Gene expression is determined by conditions. What about genetic engineering and GMO? Well, below expectation, like it doesn't increase, like the analysis in the United States after 10 years of GMO was by the USDA, the United States Department of Agriculture, who's a big supporter of GM, but on their website you can find a report that says our yields now are not higher than they would have been without GMO. Our chemical use now is not lower than it would have been without GMO. Our profits per hectare now are not higher than they would have been without GMO. The only reason why our farmers use GMO is ease of management, lazy farming. And we get new weeds, new diseases, new insects, so new problems. The same with the cotton industry in Australia. We get lower food quality because the glyphosate, the Roundup, destroys the bugs in the soil. The Roundup lingers on, and the Roundup is like a magnet for minerals. The Roundup prevents minerals to be taken up by plants. So you get like 80% less uptake of iron, zinc, magnesium. So the food quality gets lower and lower in GM crops as well. And that's quantified in a scientific paper by scientists in Argentina that were looking at the quality of food under GMO compared with non-GMO. So we get big health problems with the GMO, but the GMO industry doesn't want to accept that yet. But we keep protesting and we keep asking questions about it because it's not a solution. And this system makes a slave labor of you. You have to buy the seed of them every year, then you have to buy their chemicals, their fertilizer, and then you sell the produce through them to the market, etc. So you're a laborer of the company rather than your own independence. So then we come to the science, like the obstruction and quantification, the control by leading industries, the leading powers, the current powers. And it's following inappropriate methods. It's designed a test to get the answer wanted. Because a scientist doesn't have to lie. A scientist can design an experiment to get the answers wanted. You only ask those questions that you think that you know will give good answers. You don't ask the questions that you think will get the wrong answers. And that's how the whole system works, because they want to get money for the next research as well. And the powers of the chemical companies and the pharmaceutical companies, they rule the roost of science. And if a professor wants to have money for PhD students and scholarships, then they have to say yes, yes, yes to those powers, otherwise they don't get money. So it's ignoring the data that don't fit. So if you have big outliers that you can't explain, you say, oh, the instrument was not working that day. Yeah, oh, it was raining. Oh, always finding excuses to take outliers out of the data. And then what's reported? And the role of statistics. And like with statistics, you can prove anything. Statistics is beautiful. You can make a statement and like in your public arena, in the newspapers, you can find it all the time. And that's also like a climate change, etc. With statistics, and of course, in our own world, like here in the big drought of 82, like in the 80s, 90s, when I was doing my research, it made a big difference if you took 82 as the starting year or 1950 as the starting year. All statistics, all playing with numbers. And like that's the obstruction and quantification. So then it's a calculated risk and it's a precautionary principle. And then they believe the results thus obtained. They don't question. And it's all group thinking. Like a CSRO, they talk to the group all the time. Oh, I've done this, I've done that. It's all confirmation of their own results. And that group thinking and the peer pressure keeps them in line. And like I was always asking other questions, and then in the end I was silenced. They didn't want to talk to me because I was always asking questions. And then I was kicked out 5 years ago. So that's the paradigm effect. The paradigm effect, factors that influence outcomes. The paradigm, what influences the outcomes? It's how we learn to think, right from a baby, right from a child. Beliefs, assumptions, values, how we see the world, habits, programs in our minds. Like habits are programs in our minds that we do automatically. We can change those things. So live and work within rigid boundaries. Live and work within rigid boundaries that you're not allowed to get out. Peer pressure tries to keep us there. And that peer pressure is so strong that it's very effective. And that whole system creates filters in our thinking and vision. So we need to put up a different lens in front of our eyes to see the world in a different way, to learn to see the world in a different way. So how to obtain better solutions? Well, we go to the great Albert Einstein, and Albert said, no problem will be solved with the same level of thinking that created it in the first place. So we have to step out of our square, and we have to look at it from a different angle, and we have to ask why. Why is it happening? And then you're going to say, ah, next year will be better, or next year use 20 kilos more. Now, why is it now different? Why don't I have the results that we've expected? And if you don't ask the whys, you never grow. And you have to persist with the asking why. And I did that in the CS row with asking why for the GMO. Why is there not a health study that shows that 5 generations of mice or rats fed with GMO corn and soybean are healthy and happy and fertile? Those studies have not been published in the international literature. No long-term study. Our regulator asked for a 30-day feeding study. Well, you can feed any person 30 days for bad food and you don't see a result. Ask why. So we need new thinking, because the why is new thinking as well. Holistic management. Who of you has done a holistic management course? Like, holistic management is very important. If you haven't heard about it, you can Google on the internet or go to your local CMA office. Holistic management changes you to change your thinking. And then we apply that new thinking to new systems, the biological farming, the biological system. To no longer go with recipes of kilos per hectare and liters of chemicals and fertilizers, but go to the living organisms and develop your biosensitivity. And that's what Albert Einstein was in on about as well, because imagination drives knowledge. Albert said, I'm enough of an artist to draw freely upon my imagination. Imagination is more important than knowledge. Knowledge is limited. Imagination encircles the world. And there's a whole intuitive feeling, the whole gut feeling, intuition, that you can develop yourself in the biological system, and that Albert Einstein was doing with his research. And what did he come up with? Great new ideas, new inventions. So then we go back to the complex ecosystem, and then in that ecosystem we can imagine, we can picture how that whole system can work on our property. And that we need the trees, the shelter belts, the woodlands, the wetlands, we need all that stuff on our landscape to be profitable. So it's very important. And then of course, what I say with the inputs, a little reminder. Okay, now we get to the biological farming. And now here we are in Wylet. And Wylet has all the products and the compost, etc., and the minerals. There are lots of other companies, and also like Nutritech Solution, that sells different products, where you have one product, and like you use one product, and it doesn't work. So the next season, you use another product. Oh, it doesn't work. The next season, you use another product. Oh, it doesn't work. Ah, it's all rubbish, biological farming, and you go back to your fertilizer chemicals. Now, what happens with those products? Like the Wylet has a broad range of activators that works at the big picture system. But like when you have systems like worm use only, then like the worm vermicast, then like that stimulates like one of those wheels. So one of those wheels start to function. And in 1 year, that one wheel can't suddenly get the whole system to work immediately. So if you persist with the one wheel starting to improve, then the second year it starts to get better, the third year starts to get better, and the whole system clicks into gear and it's all rolling. So don't do the, and also like with Wylet products, don't do after 1 year say, it doesn't work, and go back to something else. So it requires appropriate policy, science, and education to connect with the wider community. So the policy development, like being allowed to sell food from your own farm, for instance, like in the Netherlands, in Germany, it's possible. Here it's illegal. And then the science catching up, and then education, training all the new people. TAFE system, very important. So the conclusion is like facts of human learning. What knowledge, whose truth? And Arthur Schopenhauer, he lived in the 19th century. Arthur said the following in that industrial revolution in the 19th century. Every truth passes through three stages before it's accepted. In the first, it's ridiculed. In the second, it's opposed. And in the third, it's regarded as self-evident. And like 10 years ago in science, I was ridiculed. 5 years ago, I was opposed, I was kicked out. So, progress. So in 10 years' time, I will see Johnny in the old people's home, and Johnny says, oh, Martin, we did a good job, eh?
Hello, thank you very much, Martin, for your inspiring talk. I'm sure out of that, you may have got something to put on your actions list. Don't forget to do it while it's fresh in your mind.